God. Amen. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever.
Today, we celebrate the Feast of the Transfiguration of Christ on Mount Tabor, where the Lord is revealed as He truly is, fully divine and fully human. In this great scene, we see not only Jesus in His glory, but also creation in its glory. Both Jesus and creation, His clothes and everything around Him shining with the uncreated light of God. Transfiguration is the destiny of all creation. It is for this that all things were made, not just human beings, but the very atoms that make up the cosmos. And our great hope here is revealed that Christ in His divinity and His human nature are in glory. Human nature, according to the fathers of our church, is a wonderful and glorious thing. Not something that's dirty or ugly. It's amazing to read what they have to say about human nature. They often speak of its beauty. Understand, writes Origen, that you are another universe, a universe in miniature, that in you there are sun and moon and stars too. If it were not so, the Lord would not have said to His disciples, "You are the light of the world," end quote. And St. Gregory the Great writes that in each one of us is a flash, a portion of the invisible Godhead. Human nature has a capacity for unlimited transcendence, a potential for unlimited intimacy with God, like that which happens between coal and fire. When the two become united and the coal glows white hot, you cannot tell the difference between the fire and the coal. They have become one and yet still retain their own features. So in the Transfiguration, human nature is existentially set free from the ravages of sin and death and the devil. And we are set free in our perception of human nature and our perception of ourselves. Jesus shows us who we really are here in the Transfiguration. We have in us a divine gift, a potential for transcendence, a capacity for transfiguration. The transfiguration of Jesus reveals many things. This is one of the most important. In Christ, divine love has embraced all of creation and invites it to become one with Him in a union that passes all understanding. We see what it means today on Mount Tabor. And we see in the confusion of Peter, James, and John that we all must admit it is far too wonderful a thing for us to understand. Therefore, the transfiguration of Christ represents for us not the addition to human nature of anything that is foreign to it, but the subtraction of everything that is foreign to it. We become saved not by becoming something other than we are, but by letting go of everything that we are not meant to be. Carl Jung put it this way: the real Christ is the God of freedom. The Lord said it just a little differently. He says, "Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." The three apostles become confused and dumbfounded because in the transfigured Lord, they see themselves, not only Christ, but themselves as they truly are. They are seen in the icon falling to the ground, practically tumbling down the mountain, covering their faces and losing their shoes. This is simply too much for them to comprehend. Peter says something silly about building three booths, one for Jesus and Moses and Elias, a reference to the Feast of Booths, which will come later, celebrated by the Jews in September. But he clearly misunderstands the point of the theophany. He speaks like a man grasping at straws for his own sanity. Why? Because what he saw that day struck him in the heart. It was a redefinition. Without the little houses of sand we build, with all our identifications to things in this world, family, jobs, nations, groups, opinions, relationships, possessions, think of all the things we identify ourselves with. Without them, we think we could not live, but they are houses built on sand. The Transfiguration reveals the truth that we do not need anything other than the gift of life itself to be alive. Only one thing is necessary to see that our connection with God is everything that we need. Man shall not live by bread alone, Jesus says, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. The motto of my family on our family crest is, God is enough. Without God, without anything, God is enough. Now Jesus usually reveals himself to his disciples in the Gospels gradually, like the wise teacher he is. He teaches them slowly and carefully, taking them step by step like little children towards greater and greater things. A good teacher is able to discern how to get his student from point A to B and to know when the student is ready to take the step. The Lord was the best of all teachers. But even after the preparation they had received, Peter, James, and John, this revelation was too much for them to take. The revelations of God sometimes stretch us beyond everything we know to make us grow. They tumble down the mountain, and at the crucifixion, they betray him, except for John. Before we can grow spiritually, certain internal conditions must be in place. The revelation of the greatest mysteries can be revealed only to the pure in heart. And the pure in heart are free of inner turmoil. They have no divided loyalties. In them the internal wars have ceased. Not that they are free of tribulation, but they remain unmoved by it. Pleasure and pain become equal. They have learned that true happiness is not getting what you want, but not caring whether you do get it or you don't get it. All inner turmoil comes from our identification with things that are foreign to who we are. Petty jealousies do not exist for those who are pure in heart. Possessiveness does not exist for those who are pure in heart. Nor fear, nor hatred, nor anger, nor judgment, nor preference. For the pure in heart, all things are pure, the Bible says. That is, in them, all dualism has ceased to be. Everything is beautiful and everything is one. To the pure in heart, the good and the bad of life comes and goes like clouds in the sky, and yet the heart remains unmoved. The pure in heart are like the sky, which is unmarred by clouds. They are like the bottom of the ocean that remains peaceful when storms rage on the surface. All the disparate parts of themselves have been reconciled in Christ, and you reunited the dark and the light, the good and the bad. Only the heart in which such peace has been established can handle the greatest mysteries. Jesus tells us that we must seek first His kingdom. That is, to have a single focus, to desire only one thing. Then, He says, everything else will be added to you. Well, what is this everything He speaks of? Our minds are thinking of clothes and food and jobs and cars and things. That's not what Jesus means. He means much more than that. He means everything else. And when He speaks of everything else, we see it in the Transfiguration. The kingdom of God in its fullness is the everything else you receive when you seek the kingdom first. And if you have the kingdom, you need nothing else. We will see, if we look deeply into the Gospels, into the Transfiguration, that the addition He speaks of everything is really a subtraction of everything we do not need and of everything that is not us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.